Certainly, the president calls the reporters the enemy of the American people. As an American citizen, I just personally think today is just an incredibly depressing moment in our time, in our history as an American. Former CIA Director John Brennan just tweeted, and I quote, "Donald Trump's press conference performance in Helsinki rises to and exceeds the threshold of high crimes and misdemeanors. It was nothing short of treasonous. Not only were Trump's comments imbecilic, he is wholly in the pocket of Putin. Republican patriots, where are you?" And that is a very good question, is what are Republicans on Capitol Hill, a co-equal branch of government, what are they going to be saying about what we have just witnessed and heard today?
Well, what's striking is that there's been this enormous flip-flop in Republican sentiment towards Vladimir Putin and towards Russia, taking their cues from Donald Trump. You've seen, of course, a dramatic change in opinion polling. And even in the behavior of Republicans on Capitol Hill, who 1 year ago were willing to raise more concerns. Remember that the Senate voted 98-2 to oppose and to codify into law the sanctions against Russia when there were initial worries right after President Trump's inauguration that he might lift the sanctions on Russia. Basically, Congress did step in. Flash forward a year later, and I think we've heard remarkably little from Republicans. You saw Senator John McCain, an increasingly isolated voice in the Republican Party after those indictments on Friday. He was basically the only senior Republican elected official to come out and say President Trump should consider canceling the summit. But you know, it strikes me that President Trump actually just had the summit he wanted to have. This was his initiative.
David Gergen, you think of, Ronald Reagan, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down that wall. Saying to Gorbachev, you know, trust but verify. They're tossing a ball around to each other. There was absolutely no backbone publicly on the part of the President of the United States in the face of Vladimir Putin.
No, the central drama, we said again and again coming into this summit, was whether the president was going to hold Putin accountable as a price for coming back on the international stage. And that was not only going to include the questions of the interference in our elections, the effort to steal the election, but it was going to include the Crimea. It was going to include what's going on in Syria. It was going to include the poisonings in London. You go down that long list. You had that list earlier. And as far as I can tell, he didn't hold him accountable in anything. And there may be something I missed.
Well, no, I mean, you haven't, basically, on this accountability and what we've been talking about a lot, this sort of me-tooism or moral relativism. When he was asked about the foolish tweet, he said he blamed the U.S. for being our side for being foolish. He doubled down on that. He said, "I hold both countries responsible. We're all to blame. We should have had this conversation a long time ago," which is a Donald Trump style. He did it after Charlottesville. He did it after a whole load of things. He's holding each side, including his own country, responsible for instance... The annexation of
the European Union is a foe. He calls Russia a competitor, a good competitor, and he means it as a compliment.
The real question also, apart from what he's just done about the interference in the election, is what are the allies going to think now? Because they were hoping that at least the Hippocratic Oath would prevail and that you wouldn't see a weakening of this Western front. But this is a week.
Well, and not only that, it comes literally within days and hours of the annual NATO summit meeting, at which there was a very strongly worded statement, by NATO, essentially restating the Western position on Ukraine and on all these associated issues. And I think it reinforces one and for all that President Trump doesn't support the policy of his own foreign policy team. He doesn't support the policy of his allies. And he takes a view that is closer to Vladimir Putin's view than perhaps Putin himself.
This is something the president said. Remember, he continually focuses on the idea that there's no collusion, which, again, the Mueller investigation is not over, but he continues to focus on that, but made no mention of no confrontation with Putin about Russia's meddling in the election, nothing about the indictments, nothing supporting the U.S. intelligence community. When point blank asked, who does he believe, Vladimir Putin or the U.S., his own U.S. intelligence community, which is his intelligence community now, he didn't say. In fact, he went on to talk about the Hillary Clinton server. Let's listen.
We have two thoughts. You have groups that are wondering why the FBI never took the server. Why haven't they taken the server? Why was the FBI told to leave the office of the Democratic National Committee? I've been wondering that. I've been asking that for months and months, and I've been tweeting it out and calling it out on social media. Where is the server? I want to know, where is the server, and what is the server saying? With that being said, all I can do is ask the question. My people came to me, Dan Coats came to me and some others. They said they think it's Russia. I have President Putin. He just said it's not Russia. I will say this. I don't see any reason why it would be, but I really do want to see the server. But I have confidence in both parties.